Great. Thank you all for coming. I'm glad to see you all not sweltering in the heat for once. I'll make a few remarks and then I'm happy to take questions. We're continuing to work very hard and we are making progress. We're not there yet. This is a very complex agreement and we are going to continue working at it. As we've said from the outset, our objective in these talks is to update and modernize NAFTA in a way that is good for Canadians, good for Americans, and good for Mexicans. We know that a win-win-win agreement is within reach, and that's what we're working towards. With goodwill and flexibility on all sides, I know we can get there. But as certainly the Canadians here have heard me say before, I'm paid in Canadian dollars. And my job is to ensure that this agreement works for Canadian workers, Canadian families, and Canadian business. The Government of Canada will not sign an agreement unless it's good for Canada and good for Canadians. And just in conclusion and before answering your questions, I'd like to thank Ambassador Lighthizer and his team. They have worked hard and in good faith with us for more than a year, including some very intense days this week. We've made good progress, but there's still work to be done.
We'll pass to questions now. Please identify yourself and your outlet. We'll do questions from the line here. One question, no follow-ups. If you want to follow up, get back in line. Thanks.
Josh Wingrove with Bloomberg News. I wanted to ask you whether...
I recognize you, Josh.
Hi, Minister. I wanted to ask you what your message to the U.S. Congress is now, whether Canada believes that President Trump would have the authority under today's notification to proceed with a bilateral-only deal, or whether he would need Canada to proceed?
You know, when it comes to the U.S. legislative process, that's really a question for the Americans and our American counterparts to answer and to sort out. That's a message for the, that's a question for the Americans, and it's really, that's their issue.
Hi, Julie Gordon from Reuters. Do you recognize me as well?
I do.
Okay, good. I mean, we keep hearing that Chapter 19 and dairy are the two main sticking points. Which of those two is not negotiable, and are there any other sticking points or things you can tell us about?
So as I said to the hardy reporters who were camped out outside USTR earlier this week, Ambassador Lighthizer and I agreed that given the absolute intensity of the negotiations right now, we wouldn't be negotiating in public. So I'm not going to talk about specific issues.
Hi, Minister.
Sorry, Lawrence.
Mackenzie Gray from CTV. President Trump had said that today was a deadline for the NAFTA negotiations. It seems like they can continue going forward on Wednesday. Are there any real deadlines to make sure that there is a NAFTA deal? And if so, what is that deadline?
For Canada, the focus is on getting a good deal. And once we have a good deal for Canada, we'll be done.
Hi, Minister. Today, Donald Trump confirmed that he made some comments off the record suggesting that the U.S. would not compromise when it came to negotiating with Canada. I know that you're not going to get into details, but have you seen any movement from the Americans that would suggest that Donald Trump's characterization of the American negotiating tactics, that characterization is not accurate?
As I said, this week and from the beginning of the negotiation, Ambassador Lighthizer and his team have been negotiating in good faith and with goodwill. This is a process that began more than a year ago. And you know, we've made some progress. We've done some work together. I see Jerry Diaz here, so I can't neglect to mention the car sector and the rules of origin. And our starting point was a place where Canada and the U.S. were quite far apart in their proposals. But what we found as the negotiation went on is Canada and the United States shared a concern for our workers in the car sector, who are high-wage workers who have felt that they can be disadvantaged by trade agreements. And one of the things that I think we are accomplishing in this agreement is a better deal for worker, Canadian and U.S. workers in the auto sector. That's important, and that's been a success due to Canada and the United States working together and due to Mexico showing some significant flexibility over the summer.
Stephanie Du with CNBC. So you mentioned the auto sector. How difficult is the pharmaceutical sector and the provisions that would cause Canadian drug prices to rise? Is that a key sticking point?
Again, I've said we're not going to negotiate in public. When it comes to the Canadian positions on issues, I think our positions are pretty clear and pretty well known. Hi, Adrian.
Hi, Chrystia. How can you possibly negotiate with a guy like Donald Trump who says that he's not going to give any ground? That's not a negotiation, is it? Like, how could you possibly make a deal with someone like that?
My negotiating counterparty is Ambassador Lighthizer. And as I said, he has brought good faith and goodwill to the table. As I also said, it is going to take flexibility on all sides to get to a deal in the end. And what I can speak to is the Canadian position. And I really want to assure Canadians that we're working hard to get a good deal. We are confident that a win-win-win deal is possible. And we're always going to stand up for the national interest and for Canadian values.
Bonjour. De Radio-Canada. Alors, Radio-Canada. M. Trudeau a répété Now, que c'était votre intention de protéger le système de gestion de l'eau. Or, on s'entend, il y a une différence entre maintenir le système et permettre des brèches, des parts de marché qui pourraient être données aux Américains. Ça inquiète beaucoup d'agriculteurs au Québec, ça inquiète les politiciens québécois qui sont en campagne. Quel message vous avez à leur envoyer aujourd'hui à propos de possibles brèches, pas de la fin du système, mais de donner des parts de marché
giving part Comme of the market dit, share to the U.S. Nous avons décidé avec l'ambassadeur Lighthizer de ne négocier pas en public et c'est très important parce que c'est un moment très critique pour les négociations et pour nous donner, pour nous laisser un espace pour négocier, c'est très important de ne pas négocier en public.
We cannot negotiate in public.
En même temps,
At
je peux
time,
dire que,
say,
comme a dit le Premier ministre, la position
said,
du gouvernement
that,
du Canada, l'intérêt national est bien connu. Nous comprenons que pour finir les négociations,
that in order to
ce sera nécessaire de trouver, de chercher des compromis.
To find some
et c'est ce que nous faisons.
And that's exactly
c'est
what we're
c'est
doing.
Une négociation.
This is a negotiation.
Toujours, notre équipe, le gouvernement du Canada,
Our
nous
team,
allons défendre l'intérêt national
we
et les valeurs canadiennes.
The national interest and Canadian
I'm Minister
values.
Jackson Perosco with Global News. With respect to President Trump's comments as reported today, did you raise those comments today with your American counterparts? Did those comments raise any questions in your mind about the sincerity of the American negotiating position? And what is your message to Canadians who wonder if this really is a negotiation or if we're being strong-armed into a specific bargaining point that the Americans would like to see?
So let me be clear yet again, because it's important, and the importance of reiterating this is underscored by your question. Canada will only sign a deal which is a good deal for Canada. We are very, very clear about that. The Prime Minister has said that on a number of occasions, including this week, that we want a good deal, not just any deal. And a good deal is one which is good for Canada and good for Canadians. A good deal is one which reflects the Canadian national interest and in which Canadian values are defended. We are absolutely clear about that. I also want to say, as I said in my opening remarks, I have now been working with Ambassador Lighthizer and his team for more than a year. We have had some very intense periods of working together. And Ambassador Lighthizer and his team are very experienced professionals. And they absolutely do bring good faith and goodwill to the negotiating table. I think this week we have, really over the course of the entire year, we now understand each other's positions very well and very clearly. And we're working hard to find those win-win compromises that we're going to need.
Did you read the comments today?
I'll take the next question.
Good afternoon, Minister. Ariel Moutazos from Televisa Mexico. You said that
Buenos
you were,
días.
Buenos días, ministra. Gracias por estar aquí. Did you, you said that you were encouraged by the progress that Mexico made in these 6 weeks, and that that would help your negotiation. Could you please elaborate a little bit? What was present now that you that you arrived into this negotiation that was not present before, that made you think that now was a negotiation or an agreement was possible and not before? Thank you.
That's a really good question. And, you know, as I have said, one probably, you know, for people who've been following this negotiation over the whole year, I think you will remember the many, many days we spent focusing on rules of origin in the car sector. This is a fiendishly complex issue, and it is the issue which really is at the heart of the NAFTA negotiation, and in the way, in the heart of the NAFTA relationship, the integrated North American car sector. We have spent, for more than a year, all three countries have focused a lot of attention on the rules of origin. And I want to take an opportunity to thank the Canadian negotiating team, which put forward some important ideas on rules of origin, particularly around the time of the Montreal round. But rules of origin are really, really complicated. And in order to achieve the landing zone which we found, some big changes were required to be made by Mexico in particular. And I think the important progress that was the most important progress, a lot was done over the summer, but the most important progress over the summer was in the rules of origin in the car sector, achieving a deal which required a lot of flexibility from Mexico in particular, and thank you for that. That has now put us in a place where we can move on to concluding, we can move on to the other issues. And the rules of origin agreement that was achieved, I think, has particular value for my government because our priority has always been middle-class Canadians and people working hard to join the middle class. And we understand the pressures on working Canadians in the 21st century economy. And we understand that working Canadians have sometimes felt that trade agreements have hurt them and hurt their interests. What is really significant about the Rules of Origin Agreement is it will be good for Canadian workers and for American workers. And that is an essential part of this NAFTA modernization.
Time for two more questions.
Minister, thank you. Edward Lawrence with Fox Business Network. Were you surprised by the scope of the agreement that was signed with Mexico and the U.S., including other industries like digital trade? Also, what's your feeling on intellectual property of companies? Now, in general, does it need to be expanded?
So, as I said, I am not going to negotiate in public. What I will say, though, is the negotiations with Canada are not complete. And we continue to negotiate with the United States. So that's why we're coming back next Wednesday. And we're going to continue talking until we reach a good deal.
Bill Thompson, AgriPulse. You've said that Canada will only accept a good deal.
That's right. I hope you wouldn't imagine that Canada would be looking for a not good deal.
I can't imagine that, no.
Good.
Can you consider any deal that doesn't include a continuation of the dairy supply management system in Class 7 a good deal?
I used to be a reporter, and I understand the extreme frustration everyone here is feeling. And it really hurts me to be imposing that frustration on all the hardworking reporters here. But let me just reiterate that the Canadian national interest and Canadian values are at the core of our negotiating approach and our negotiating priorities. The core Canadian positions are well known, I think, by everyone and certainly by our negotiating partners. And having said that, really, as we are in this intense period, I am absolutely convinced, and Ambassador Lighthizer and I agreed that the best way to get a good deal was not to be negotiating in public, and I'm going to stay true to that agreement.
Thank you, Minister. Inside U.S. Trade. I wanted to ask about the steel and aluminum tariffs. Will Canada accept a deal that doesn't include lifting those tariffs? And would you accept some kind of quota arrangement that some of the other countries have? Thank you.
So on the 232 steel and aluminum tariffs, Canada has said from the very outset of the 232 considerations that this was an issue entirely separate from NAFTA. And that is not an opinion, that is a matter of fact. Section 232 is a national security consideration. It is not one of the NAFTA negotiating chapters. Having said that, we very much are opposed to these tariffs. They are unjustified and they are illegal. The notion that somehow Canadian steel or aluminum could pose a national security threat to the United States is, frankly, absurd. We are very clear about that.
That's all the time we have. Thanks, everyone.
Okay, thank you very much. I imagine I'll be seeing quite a few of you next Wednesday. I look forward to that.